I welcome you to today's ECD Star introductory colloquium on the science topics of the workshop Tomography of Light Nuclei at an Electron Ion Collider, which was planned for 2020 but has been shifted to 2021 because of the COVID-19 pandemic. As you know, the intention of this colloquium series is to introduce and publicize the science case of the workshop to a wider audience. Today's presentation will be given by Sergio Scopetta from the University of Perugia. Let me briefly introduce the speaker. Sergio got his PhD in 1995 from the University of Perugia, working on the structure of light nuclei with high energy electromagnetic probes. After his PhD, he held several postdoc positions in Mainz, Valencia, and also at ECT Star. As a postdoc, Sergio performed theoretical studies on the structure of the nucleon in deep inelastic scattering experiments. Since 2007, he is professor in nuclear and subnuclear physics at the physics department of the University of Perugia. His current research interest is on the platonic structure of nucleons and nuclei, focusing on multi-partron interactions as probed by hadron colliders such as the LHC, but also with high-energy electromagnetic probes available at a new generation of high-luminosity facilities, such as Jefferson Lab and the future Electron Ion Collider. Sergio, thanks for agreeing to give this talk.
Good morning. I will talk about generalized parton distributions of light nuclei. And actually, this is not a normal talk because, first of all, it is given through the web, as you see. And above all, this is a colloquium. So it is not a normal talk, and I was asked to give such a presentation by the organizers of this workshop, Tomography of Light Nuclei at an Electron Ion Collider, which has been postponed from June 2020 to October 2021. Because of the well-known health situation, which is a global one. And hopefully such an event will take place in person in 1 year from now. And well, so it is my task today to convince you that what we are proposing is relevant, is beautiful, and it is timely, and looking forward to the real workshop. Let me just spend a few words concerning ECT Star, which is a place I am very fond of because I have been a postdoc there more or less 20 years ago, and I spent a very nice time there, and it's always a pleasure to be back, even if this time it cannot be in person. I found in my disk this picture, which was taken in the year 2000, and it is, well, I like it, because in this picture, among the others, you can see myself and Rudy Manfred, Professor Manfred, who was the director at that time, and a young Professor Bamba, who is the director of ECT Star right now. So I hope to go back there because it's a great place for physics and for many, many other things. So let me start with the real presentation, and this is the outline. So I will try to be pedagogical at the beginning, just introducing the problem of the parton structure of nuclei, and will describe why it is elusive. And I will propose a possible solution, one of the possible solutions, which uses the tool of generalized parton distribution, the GPDs, which allows the so-called tomography. I will stress the role of light nuclei in this physics. And as an example, I will show results of my group concerning deeply built quantum scattering of helium isotopes, helium-3 and helium-4. And then the perspectives, which are strongly related to the parallel experimental programs which are going on at high luminosity facilities, such as the Jefferson Laboratory, which is running with the electron beam at 12 GeV, and in particular the electron-ion collider, which will be built in the States in this decade. And Tomography of Light Nuclei at Electron-Ion Collider is the title of the postponed workshop, as you have seen before. Let me for a while start from the very beginning, just to see which is the framework where our investigation takes place. So the general topic is deep inelastic scattering, DIS. So we have the inclusive scattering of electrons of a hadron target. The only detected particle is an electron. And if we go in the laboratory frame and in the Bjorken limit, which means that the energy transfer and the momentum transfer is very high, it is well known, it is written in textbooks, we teach this to our students, that we have the scaling phenomenon. So the cross-section is proportional to the structure function, F2, which depends only on one variable, x, and this structure function, in turn, can be expressed through this parton distribution functions, which are giving the number density of partons of a given type Q carrying a fraction x of the momentum of the target. Such an x is the Bjorken variable, and it assumes the meaning of momentum fraction in the so-called infinite momentum frame when the longitudinal momentum of the target is very high. So this Bjorken scaling means that at different Q squared, at fixed t, the F2 such a function actually does not depend on Q squared. We have here a wide interval, but all the points are in the same position, as you see, up to experimental error bars. So let me go to nuclei, because the European Union collaboration in 1983, almost 40 years ago, measured the same thing using nuclear targets. And in particular, this ratio was studied, and this is the ratio of the F2 structure function of a proton bound in iron to the same quantity for a proton bound in the deuteron, which is assumed to be, I mean, since it is very weakly bound, it can be assumed as a free particle. It was expected that this ratio for any x should be very close to one, because, of course, as I said, the momentum transfer is very high, while the momentum of the nucleons inside the nucleus is something like one inverse Fermi, 200 MeV in average, while the momentum transfer could be some maybe 10 or even 100 GeV. So it was expected basically one. So it was expected this kind of trend here given by the full line, while experimentally, this is the original plot, was found something completely different. A big effect, some 20% effect, which is seen in this plot. And such a result is still heavily cited today. It is very strongly debated because it is basically not understood. But in a naive parton model interpretation, one could see here that the fast partons seem to be less, seems to have less fast quarks in the bound proton than in the free one, which means probably that in coordinate space, if we use the indetermination principle, the quarks are slower in a nucleus, which means in turn that maybe the nucleon in nuclei is a little bit bigger than in the free situation. This is the naive interpretation. Of course, one can perform other experiments that have been done. Such a variable X, Bjorken X for nuclei can range between 0 and A, not between 0 and A, and not between 0 and 1, like for the free proton, sorry. Different regions can be seen in this plot. The real EMC1 is in the valence region between 0.2 and 0.8, and the trend is rather simple, it's rather natural, rather is basically a straight line behavior. And the interpretations are different. I don't want to go into this because this would be a different talk, but there is a strong debate if it is mainly a global property due to the density of the system or to the local density due to nucleon-nucleon correlations, for example. This can be discussed because these data alone are not enough to distinguish between different interpretations. So there would have been many exotic explanations in terms, for example, of the presence of 6, 9 quark bags in the nucleus, not only standard nucleons in the nucleon medium, which is very unsatisfactory because if we have different explanations of the same phenomenon, it means that we have not an explanation, actually. No? And nonetheless, this is very important to understand this point because for other fields in physics, not only for nuclear physics at high energy, but for example, to study the neutron parton distributions, which are crucial to test many fundamental some rules in QCD, so I mean in fundamental physics, neutral targets are necessary and this kind of behavior should be clarified. And also the knowledge of neutron parton distributions is necessary for the understanding of, for example, heavy ion collisions, to see the onset of the formation of quark gluon plasma, for example. So one has to understand this behavior. And one way, according to me and to Raphael Dupré, for example, we have written this report some years ago, the one possibility is to go beyond the inclusive measurements and to see other kind of processes. And the one I am going to discuss here is hard exclusive processes described in terms of the generalized parton distributions. So this is the way out according to this possibility I am describing. In order to understand whether a section of the nucleus resembles this scheme here, where I have the conventional description of a nucleon in terms of quarks. So the bound nucleon has the same parton structure than the free one, or this other kind of exotic bag with 6 valence quarks, for example. To understand whether or not this exotic configuration, for example, is correct, one should perform a tomography, no? And such a tomography, in some sense, it has been demonstrated that it can be done using the generalized parton distributions and, for example, deeply Wilton compass scattering SC process. Let me try to explain to you how it can be achieved. This is the formal definition of the parton distribution. It is a density, it's a number density of partons with a given momentum fraction. And technically, this is the expectation value in a state with a given momentum p. The kinematics which is involved is the light cone kinematics, where the momentum of the target is very high, the so-called infinite momentum frame, which I have already introduced. So one has these bilocal operators relating the parton into different points in coordinate space. And Fourier transforming this matrix element to get a parton distribution, one gets distribution of quarks. This is a density because it is related to the squared of the scattering amplitude. And due to the optical theorem, this is forward, no? So you have the same situation in the initial and in the final state. In order to see something more and to have more information, one could think to have an experiment which is not diagonal, not forward, detecting in the final state the photon, but the virtual photon cannot be detected, so one can think to have a real photon in the final state. So this is a deeply virtual contrascattering, a contrascattering with photons, but I have an initial virtual photon in the initial state, and I am in the Bjorken limit, so I can use the infinite momentum frame interpretation. So the same blob here in this non-diagonal case is not described simply by densities, but by these GPDs, no? Which are the probability amplitudes, actually. And they depend in this complicated process on 3 invariants, not only x, but also t, or delta squared, which is the momentum transfer to the target, which recoils elastically, does not break up, and this xi, which is a fraction of longitudinal momentum transfer to the target. So if we have that momentum transfer is only longitudinal, so we have no transverse momentum, it happens, it can be shown, actually, that would be an exercise, but I have no time to go through it, that the cross-section in the unpolarized case depends only on one GPD, And by performing the Fourier transform from this transverse momentum space to the transverse position space to impact parameter space, we have from a probability amplitude just a density. So this has a probabilistic interpretation, while the GPDs alone have not, and one can perform the tomography I was trying to address, because in this way we have the probability to have the quark with a given momentum fraction at a given transverse distance from the transverse center of the target. So we could see whether slow or fast partons are more or less localized in the transverse plane of the target. This could provide us with a sort of pictorial representation of the EMC effect, because we could, if we have data for nuclei, we could compare the data for the nuclei to the data for the free nucleon and see the difference and see, try to explain the source of this complicated behavior, which is the EMC effect. So let me go a little bit into some more formal definition of the GPDs. This is for a spin one-half target, can be generalized to any target spin. This is physics which has been developed about more than 20 years ago, the first papers by G. Radiushkin and Dieter Müller in particular. And what we get is a description of this Lightcon correlator describing this process in terms, if we have no polarization in the target, of two GPDs, H and D, depending on the invariance that I have introduced. And it is important for the rest of the talk, of the colloquium, to remind that in the forward limit, so if we have no momentum transfer to the target, this delta is zero, we have only Q, we recover the standard forward situation, and the GPDs should yield the just the PDS. And by X integration the GPDs, one gets, it is seen from this expression easily, the standard Dirac and Pauli form factors, for example, if we have the H and D GPDs, which are the one obtained in an unpolarized setup and without elicit flip of the target. It is a flip of the quark, sorry. So these are information which are included in the GPDs, but there are many more information. For example, the tomography I was discussing before, but not only the tomography, because if we have information in the transverse plane and we have a deep elastic process where everything is going through the longitudinal direction, we have information also in the transverse plane. So we have information, for example, on the component of the orbital angular momentum of the partons in the longitudinal direction, which is related to the momenta in the transverse plane, which are accessible in this way. So that it can be seen that the orbital angular momentum is related to the GPDs, and this could contribute to the solution of the so-called spin crisis, which is another long-standing problem in electronic physics, not only the EMC effect, but also the spin crisis. This is not discussed heavily in my colloquium, but it is a very important point. Actually, maybe this is the main reason why GPDs were introduced. And of course, everything is very complicated anyway, because this DVCS process is exclusive. So one detects an electron, a photon, a recurring target. So cross sections are very small compared to inclusive DIS, for example. The extraction is difficult because the GPDs are not proportional to the scattering amplitude. They appear in convolution with propagators. So this kind of distribution should be obtained by the convolution of the data. The data are available, or will be available, for these quantities called the Compton form factor. So this deconvolution is complicated, and on the top of that, in experiments, for example, like the ones performed at JLab, the Bethe-Eitel process, which has the same final state you see here, compete, interfere with the DVCS, and the information is actually obtained from this interference term here. Despite of everything, with some model dependence, anyway, some sort of tomography has been extracted, for example, in these papers, for the free proton. And for the nucleus, one could dream to have something similar. For the nucleus, we can think to two different kind of tomographies. If we have coherent DVCS, so the nucleus is detected in the final state as a whole, if it does not break up, we could have a tomography of the full system. While if we detect in the final state a recoiling proton here, we have the so-called incoherent DVCS, and one could get the tomography of the bound nucleons. So one can see definitely the pictorial realization of the EMC effect. But let me show that the tomography is not the only goal of these GPDs measurements. And to test that, let me show how one can study in impulse approximation coherent DVCS of a nucleus. So first of all, we go to the handbag approximation, which means only that we are scattering on one part of the target, which is the standard leading twist, description of the target. And this situation is is again approximated with the further approximation, which is the impulse approximation. So what you have here is that not only you have only one parton interacting, but such a parton belongs to one nucleon, and such a nucleon does not interact further with this nuclear recalling system. And this is the approximation. I will go back to this point a little bit later. And to describe theoretically the simple approximation, one has to study this diagram here, and one has to introduce some x and psi prime variables, which are related not to the nucleus, but to the bound proton. So we have another step of complexity in the problem, if you want. But for a given GPD, which is given by the expression I have already shown, to perform such approximation, one can think to introduce these states into this description in terms of this one-body operator here. So I put to the left and to the right-hand side of this one-body quark operator a complete set of states describing the interacting nucleon and the recoiling spectator system in this way. And now, if I have no further scattering, this one-body operator is selecting the one-body nucleon states, giving a sort of matrix element for this operator for the bound nucleon. So basically a GPD for the bound nucleon. And the rest is just this overlap of the nuclear states with these other states, this quasi-free nucleon and this recalling system. So that one has this kind of overlap, which can be written in a relativistic situation or in a left front relativistic situation as the center of mass motion, which is given by this momentum conservation, times an intrinsic overlap. So one ends with a convolution formula for the nuclear GPDs in terms of the GPD of the nucleon, which has to be later used in the calculation in the form of a model or data whenever they are available. But from the nuclear physics point of view, one has this left cone of diagonal momentum distribution, and to calculate this part, one needs this complicated spectral function for the nucleus, which is non-diagonal because in the initial and final state, the structure nucleon has a different momentum. And if you are curious to see some details on how this impulse approximation works and the expressions which are derived, you can check, for example, these references here, which are quite general. Let me show what can be learned from DVCS of nuclear in the coherent case, for example. So this kind of approach has the correct limits, because if we integrate over x, we get the full factor, the nucleus, as already anticipated, it has to be found, it's a general property of GPDs, and in the forward limit we recover the PDF which are expected to be found in the forward limit for GPDs. This is the standard expression which is found in impulse approximation studies of the PDF, and it is ruled, it is governed by this light cone momentum distribution, which is very narrow, as you see. But in the non-forward case, we have a momentum transfer and a longitudinal momentum transfer, so this variable z actually changes. And if we want to measure this recalling system with a modified z component, such a difference between z and z prime has to be more narrow than the width of this already narrow distribution. So it is very likely that if we are able to perform an experiment with a given xi, which is measuring the momentum, longitudinal momentum transfer, which is big enough to be wider than this width, input approximation predicts the cross section to be zero, predicts no DVGS process. If something were found, it would mean that input approximation doesn't work, which means, for example, that degrees of freedom different from the nucleonic ones are having a role, which is very important to be found, for example, because in standard DIS, this is seen in very complicated situations when your Bjerknex is larger than one, which means that one has very fast partons in very fast nucleons, which are very few, in such a way that the cross-section is very small and the data are not accurate enough to have conclusive findings. I have no time to go in many other very important issues. For example, the fact that one can get from GPDs four factors of the energy momentum tensor, which can be related in turn to the momentum and forces experienced by the quarks in nuclei. And this is the paper by Maxim Polyakov, which started this investigation. And also the LOX behavior, which is very important for the Lettwein collider, for example, is very interesting because there one can access the gluon GPDs and study the shadowing in these exclusive processes. And this is also planned to be measured by the class collaboration in the next years. I will not discuss the deuteron, which is an issue aside. The theory can be shown here in these papers and in others which are listed later. But what is very important, and it is my point, my most important contribution in this field for the nuclear GPDs, I think, is that I think that light nuclei, so the deuteron, helium 3, helium 4, are extremely important because for this kind of nuclei we can perform realistic calculations that by definitions are calculations using S ingredients, exact solutions of the Schrödinger equation using the exact quotation marks potentials. So the realistic potential, for example, are cognitive, and using also three body forces. So that the spectral functions that I have introduced, which are used, are in a sense the correct one predicted in a conventional approach. In such a way, if deviations were found, disagreements were found from this kind of behavior, those could be ascribed to exotic effects and not to approximations performed in the calculation. This is crucial because the process is complicated. And for helium 3, we have already, since some years, we have a complete realistic calculations, and we have proposed these measurements at JLab and at the Lettwein collider. We are presently updating these results, while for helium 4, we have very recent results. And which is very important is that data are finally available from JLab in papers which have been published in 2017-2019. I will cite them properly in one of the next slides, which makes much more exciting the field. If data are available and many data are coming, everything becomes very, very interesting. So let me start from helium 3, although I will be fast for this target. I think most of you know that helium 3 is a very special target, and it is always promising when one wants to study spin degrees of freedom, because for polarized helium 3, basically the polarization comes from the neutron, which is inside helium 3, which is basically 90% polarized like the nucleus. So, for example, to study the neutron in a polarized setup, the helium 3 is very promising, always, and also for the GPDs measurements. Besides, this is the nucleus which is best known theoretically, because the deuteron, one cannot say that it is a real nucleus. It's a very specific, very peculiar system. Nuclear effects are very small. Here, nuclear effects start to be relevant, and it is not isoscattered, so one can look for isospin corrections, isospin violations, and also something related to different numerous modifications of the different PDFs corresponding to different flavors. This is much more difficult to be seen on a deuterium or on a helium-4 target. So from the point of view of spin, the helium-3 is like a proton, spin 1/2. So the technology which is used to extract the different quantum four factors and in turn the different GPDs corresponds to the same one used for the proton. So with different polarization setups, one can access different GPDs. I don't go into details here. I just want to show that in the past we have obtained convolution formula for all the GPDs at an twist and kernel even of helium-3. And we have performed a calculation that will show some results obtained with exact spectral function coming from our friends in Pisa, Alejandro Chiesch and Michele Viviani, using the argon 18 potential and urban aligned three-body forces. So it is, I think, a very efficient calculation, a very modern one. For the nucleon model, we used the VGG model, and we are now updating the calculation using a most recent one. And a few words on the spectral function. The input approximation calculation, if it is correctly performed, is already a very complicated one, because in the spectral function, as I said, one has these overlaps, and in these overlaps, one has all the possible final states here. So, for example, for helium-3, we can have a deuterium state plus a nucleon, or a two-body scattering state, and everything has to be calculated in the same framework with the same potential, which is used to calculate the helium-3 wave function. So, one needs the complete sets of wave functions in the final state. For helium-3, this can be done, it is well known, it is done since several years, and we have the correct complete description. And okay, in the spin-dependent case, such a function is not a density, it's a 2x2 matrix. And let me remark that this spectral function is a density, it's a probability, but it is a sort of, how to say, condition probability, because indeed this is probably to have a nucleon with a given moment and a given removal energy, but at the same time this recalling system has to be a given excitation energy, so it should be a specific example of that spectrum. So in principle this is a complicated calculation, and input approximation is known to work. I have just reported here some data to get the arbitrative calculations for helium-3 in a specific quasi-elastic kinematics. But the point here is just that input approximation is seen to work rather well if Q squared, the momentum transfer, becomes large enough of the order of 1 GV squared or more. So one expects this to be valid also in GPD, also in DVCS. Everything has to be confirmed, of course, by experiments. And in this kind of calculations, the nucleon which is interacting is off shell. It is off shell because this nucleus here is excited. So the energy of the struck nucleon is not related to the mass only. Okay? So there is an off shellness driven by neural dynamics. There is a drawback of this fact, and the momentum sum rule turns out to be slightly violated. Slightly, but this is a relevant drawback of the approach, and it must be always reported. So, nevertheless, this calculation have a reasonable forward limit, so we have an EMC-like behavior. The charge for factor is correctly reproduced if we perform an X integration. The comparison with data is good enough for low values of the momentum transfer. Here, I have shown that these ratios, which should be 1 if nuclear effects were not present. You see that the ratio is not 1, and you see that the nuclear effects are bigger by increasing the momentum transfer delta squared and by increasing the skewness psi. This is mostly true for the D flavor rather than for the U flavor. You see this fact here. For the D flavor, I have a stronger effect, and this kind of effect is absolutely conventional. It has to do with the fact that in helium-3, the deuteron, in helium-3, the D quark, which is contained in the neutron more than in the proton, is affected by the fact that the neutron is a little bit faster than the two protons in the neutrino. So the neutron modifications are a bit bigger, but this is not seen in the forward case, or it is a very small effect, which is impossible to see experimentally, according to impulse approximation, at least performed in this calculation. So the light cone momentum distribution in the forward case shows a little difference between the neutron and the proton, which is seen in this little difference in the ratio that I have defined for different flavors. In the non-forward case, I have this other kind of situation where the light cone non-diagonal momentum distribution is more different between proton and neutron rather than in the forward case, and this kind of effect, which is completely conventional, is seen. This could be studied, for example, using a Triton target, which is almost impossible, but at class, at JLab, it is maybe possible, and certainly it will be possible at the electron-ion collider. So this points to interesting effects to see which is the flavor content of the nucleons in nuclei, and see how it is modified by the nuclear environment. Another point here is that if we disregard the binding energy, the removal of the energy distribution in the spectral function, we have this kind of effect in the forward case. So a sizable effect, but not very big. If you are in the non-forward case, typical of GPDs, we have a much bigger effect. So one has to be very careful when the interpretation of GPD's data will take place in the next year. And this is possible to do such analysis only thanks to few body systems where this object can be calculated precisely, exactly. So effect of 5-6% are completely under control. This is the importance of light nuclei in this context. So let me basically skip this. This is a summary of what we have done for helium-3. And let me go to something which is a little bit more interesting, at present at least, because for helium-4 we have data. We have data in both the coherent, with detection of the final state nucleus, and incoherent, with detection of the final proton cases. And this has been achieved, the very important achievement, I think, by the class collaboration, the EG6 experiment by Attaway and co-workers in these two papers published in PRL in 2017-2019. Before, it has been very difficult to distinguish these channels just because the measurement itself is very complicated, because here you have a very fast electron, a very fast photon, and a very slow recalling. So in the same detector, or the same detector, the same setup of detectors, you should be able to detect fast and slow systems, which turns out to be very tricky. But in this collaboration, it was achieved. So we have data for this. And since we have data, there are previous calculations by Liuti and co-workers, by the Musei and co-workers. We updated, we have done our realistic microscopic calculation. I've done this together with Sara, who is a PhD student working with me in Perugia. She will finish in a few months. And Michele Viviani, who is a senior scientist from Pisa, is a world expert in few body systems and in particular in for helium-4. So for helium-4, we studied this coherent process, as I have already shown before. But for helium-4, when studying this scattering amplitude, we have in the final states several possibilities. We have not only, for example, a recalling nuclear system such as helium-3 or Triton according to the fact that we have a neutron and a proton interacting. We can have also deuteron plus another nucleon with a given interaction between themselves, and above all, and very challenging to be evaluated, we have this contribution here, where we have a three-body interacting final state, and the solution of Schrödinger equation for this system with realistic potential is unknown. And actually, with Michele, we are trying to find a way to calculate that. And this is work in progress. For the time being, we have only this term, which is realistically described. So we have got, as always, this kind of convolution formula, and we have this light cone of diagonal momentum distribution for helium-4. And the calculation has been done using for the GPDs in the coherent case I am discussing, the well-known Kolostov-Kroll model, which is a model for the Newtonian GPDs to be put into the deconvolution formula. And such a model has been built to be valid at Q squared values, which are a little bit larger than those of the data available. For the Newgrad part, as I said, we have a correct description of the overlaps defining the spectral function only when the recalling system is in the ground state. So in this case, we have a full four-body and three-body variational calculation of the wave functions corresponding to this correlated harmonical, correlated hyperspherical harmonics methods within this interaction you've already said. But in the other two channels, we have the model, and the model of the spectral function has been updated using an idea by Vidiani and co-workers in this paper, which is in turn an update of the well-known two-body, two nucleon correlation models by Choff and Simon. So in summary, we have at the moment the correct ground description, while for the rest of the spectral function, which is important, we are not yet realistic. Despite of this, we have in the forward limit the expected forward behavior. We have a good description of the four factor at low momentum transfer, which is where experiments are likely to be done. And this is the description of the data that we have for this quantity, which is the beam spin assembly. So the beam and electrons are polarized with plus or minus helicity, and of course even four cannot be polarized, so it is unpolarized. This U means unpolarized, and in different Q-squared, Bjorken-X and T-beams, the ones which have been selected by the experimental collaboration, we are in touch with them, we are collaborating with them, we have a very satisfactory description of the available data, which are affected at the moment by large error bars. But these error bars will be reduced by the next experimental measurements because of the increased luminosity which is expected at JLab at 12 GeV. So these EG6 data are nicely described, and from this data, the experimental collaboration was also able to extract information on the imaginary and real part of the Compton four factors separately, because this alpha 1 up to alpha 3 coefficients are in principle known, calculated, and be used. And also for these two quantities, we have a good description by our model, the way these quantities are obtained from our model for the GPDs is shown here. This is the standard definition. So we have a good agreement. We have a problem here with the real part at a given point, but the data are really sensitive to the real part. So this was in a sense, this is in a sense not a big problem, but of course, next data will challenge our calculations because the error bars will be much smaller, so that we have a lot of work to be able to understand what will go on. Let me go to the last achievements of our groups, of my group, described in this paper and in this very recent one, which has been submitted. We analyzed the incoherent channel, so with the detected proton that are available, I have already said, and in this case, the same observable is measured with detecting the photon in the final, the proton in the final state, or also the photon, as I said, and building this observable ratio of the difference to the sum of the cross sections. And in this paper, we have a detailed demonstration of this complicated convolution formula. I mean, the structure shown here is a sort of compact way to show the things. It is actually rather complicated. Again, the off-chainness is driven by the Newton dynamics, and we have a slight violation of the momentum sum rule. And this is maybe what we get for the differential cross section, which is used to build the experimental observable. So we have a complicated nuclear expressions for this cross section. So we have the spectral function, which is diagonal in this case, and we have a complicated kinematical term here, G, which is given in the paper. And this is the expression which is found for this quantity in imperfect approximation. Everything has been evaluated, these amplitudes for the Betti Arita process, for the DVCS process, for the interference, had to be derived for a moving bound nucleon, because in the literature so far only quantities for a free proton were available. And to evaluate this DVCS amplitude, one needs, of course, the GPDs. And for the GPDs, in these recent calculations, we used two different models, the GK, already introduced, and this Mainbrand-Mouttard-Sabatier model that we have taken from the Parton's tool, which is available online. And again, for the spectral function, we use the model which I have discussed before, based on the ergonetin plus urban antibody forces. This is the result. The result of the data from the EG6 collaboration compare with this calculation performed changing the nucleon model. So the nuclear part is the same for the red and for the blue dots. And you see that there is an agreement with both models with the data in most cases, but at log Q squared, at log Yerkes, which means also log Q squared, and at low values of minus t, which one can check also is related to log Q squared, this model, MMS, seems to work better than the GK model, which is supposed to work actually at higher values of Q squared. So it seems that we have a reasonable description of this data. Yes, it seems the input approximation for the time being with this kind of precision in the data is able to reproduce the gross features at least of the data. And of course, in this kind of processes, which are shown again here, one cannot exclude that here finite state interactions take place. This is a finite state where one can have strong interactions. And this should be taken into account, as I write here. I mean, one should study the interplay between the different momenta which are transferred in this process. There are two transfer momenta, T and Q squared. And the calculation of finite state interactions, in this case, to analyze the present data, is very tricky, very complicated, because we don't know what is this X state in the finite state. So this could be everything, as I said. So we should perform many calculations. And for one wave functions with the three particles in the scattering state, we don't have a wave function. But at the electron-ion collider, or maybe also at JLab detecting in the finite state the Triton, for example, if we knew that in the finite state we have this kind of recurring system, maybe some good realistic calculation could be performed, because here we have the cross-section between the proton and the neutrino, for example, between the proton and Triton, actually, the neutron and the neutrino. So this means that it is a sort of calculation which can be performed. So thinking to a configuration such as one of the collider, where this kind of extremely exclusive processes are possible, because at the collider everything is forward. One can measure also this recalling system, which is very slow in the laboratory system. In the collider configuration, this is very fast again, and can be detected far away from the scattering place. This makes the measurement more affordable. So for this kind of physics, the electron-ion collider, for many reasons, not only for the one I am addressing here, of course, will be a wonderful place to play. But let me remind you that such a machine has been approved, and the construction should start in the next years. And data taking is expected to be effective at the end of this decade. This is a completely new machine, because it is the first electron-nucleus collider. It is the first electron-proton collider where polarized proton beams and polarized light ions can be installed. For example, I was saying before, polarized helium-3 can be used for the first time to measure DVCS. and that is very interesting. Even the Triton, probably, because it is a beam, one doesn't need to have a target in the lab with a radioactive target. And so these are the energies which are involved, the luminosity which is expected, and this is something which is comparable, the energy is comparable to the one at ERA, but the luminosity is much bigger, so one can perform this kind of complicated exclusive measurements. Indeed, the yellow report for this project, which is a global one, here you see the numbers which are growing, of course, there is a very strong activity in this NANS. We are very strongly involved because the yellow report should be ready by this year 2020, and there are seven, seems to be, working groups, and one of them is about exclusive processes. And we in Perugia, together with the group of Orsay, we are developing an event generator, which is crucial to decide the setup or even the position of the detectors for this machine, you understand. And such an event generator is based on the work presented here, because this kind of results are not centrally defined at the end of the story. We need other effects to be included. This is valid also for the coherent case, but to have an event generator which can be taken seriously to plan the measurements, it is quite enough. And such two-peg event generator is under construction, and we have already preliminary encouraging results. From the theoretical point of view, let me stress that everything should be done, introducing some relativity somehow, and we have a light front prescription which is ready for Helium 3. We have to perform the calculations, and I hope to have these results in a few months, in a few years. For Helium 4, it looks very, very difficult, actually, so it is for the future. And so these are the perspectives of our work for Helium 3 and Helium 4. I will not repeat them, we have just more or less discussed them. Let me just point out that our spirit is that of introducing one ingredient at a time. For example, impulse approximation is the first step. And to have a good, realistic impulse approximation calculation is already a challenge, it's already very difficult for Helium 4, for example. Once it is set up, we can introduce shadowing effect, off-shell effects, whatever. If we cook a little bit of everything from the very beginning, we lose the capability to distinguish between the final effect of these different physical processes. So we think that at the very end, we don't need to introduce many exotic effects if conventional effects can be used, or conventional effects plus something. So we don't want to use more effects than those which are strictly necessary. This is our spirit. And of course, this is a colloquium on a postponed workshop. I cannot speak of everything, because as I said, there is a strong activity on this field in this month, because measurements are possible. The class collaboration demonstrated it. The Light Wire Collider is coming. New measurements are planned and underway at JLab. So theorists, phenomenologists are very active, and those lattice calculations of PDFs and related quantities for light nuclei are now possible. I think these will be subjects included in the workshop we are going to attend in 1 year from now. And let me thank the organizers to have proposed such an argument for a nice workshop at the City Star. I am sure that in 1 year from now, many other contributions will appear, and I hope to have something more also on my side. So let me thank again the organizers. Let me thank my collaborators, the ones at least collaborating with me in this subject. And above all, let me thank all of you for your kind attention. Thank you very much, and goodbye.